Before he went to sleep, Jonah would pray and ask God if there was a new message for him to deliver. And this night, there was a message that would change Jonah's life.
A new message? Yes. What's that? People being unkind? Lying? Stealing? Oh, dear. Sounds like a standard turn and repent to me. All right, name the town. I'll be on my way first thing in the morning. Where is it? Jericho? Damascus? What? Nineveh? I'm not aware of any Ninevehs in Israel. No, I don't think... Oh, you mean that Nineveh?
That Nineveh wasn't in Israel at all. It was the capital of Assyria, and it was the biggest, meanest city around. Now, the people of Nineveh were particularly mean to Jonah's people, the Israelites. They lied, they stole, but worst of all, they slapped people with fishes. They even slapped each other with fishes. They didn't know the difference between right and wrong. The Ninevites were so mean, in fact, that most Israelites, including Jonah, wished God would just wipe Nineveh off the face of the earth. Jonah was shocked that God would want him to deliver a message to his enemies.
You don't want me to go there. You don't know what Nineveh is like. Perhaps you've never been there. Well, of course you haven't. A god like you would never go to a place like Nineveh. For that matter, neither would a prophet like me. Oh. No, it cannot be. Your messages are meant for me and my brothers. We are your chosen people. Nineveh? Well, they're not! There must be some mistake, a big misunderstanding. It's really hard to take. How could you be so demanding? For years I've been your messenger, from Morasheth to Gath. But Nineveh should get no chance to turn. They've earned your wrath. No, it cannot be. Your messages are meant for me and my brothers. We are your chosen people. And Nineveh? Well... They're not! We're the good guys, and they're the bad guys! Please don't send me there with a message of your mercy! Damascus or Jerusalem, I'll be there in a minute. Any town in Israel, just ask me, I'll be in it! Shiloh, Gilgal, Jericho, just say the word. But Nineveh, that is just absurd. Joppa, Aphek, Jezreel, they're all just fine! But Nineveh... Oh, Nineveh. No, Nineveh is where I draw the line.
Who doesn't love a singing asparagus?
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I don't think you can be too old to love VeggieTales. I know I probably zone into them more than my kids do. From the video today, we're going to learn about Jonah. I won't be preaching. Nikki won't be preaching, Herb won't be preaching. We have a privilege to have Pastor Randy here with us, and we'll hear more about this message from him today. So let us pray. Father God, it is always a blessing to be in your presence, to worship you, to come to know you through your word, to sing our songs of praise, to give our prayers and ask for your guidance, your love, your wisdom, and your direction. Let us enjoy this moment with friends and family as we sing these songs and listen to the message and the hopes that we will be guided on the path that you choose for us. All this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Who doesn't love a singing asparagus? Come on. That's great stuff. And just fair warning, if you're a fish slapper, you might want to pay attention today. Just saying.
I told you my story, you would hear hope and wouldn't let go. If I told you my story, you would hear love and never gave up. If I told you my story, all of my sin, of when justice was served, and when mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of Him. If I told you my story, if I told you my story, you would hear freedom that was won for me. If I told you my story, you would hear life overcome the grave. If I
wouldn't mind opening up your programs, please. As is our custom here at Open Arms, you'll find a white connection card, prayer requests on the front, any information you feel like giving. They will be for John Eyes only, if you want to check the box on the back there. Otherwise, any prayer requests will be given to the prayer team, and they will pray in that room back there on Wednesday nights. And when all's said and done, John will shred them.
That's true. So we encourage you to go ahead and take time to fill out the information on the card. And we're, wow, Jonah, What do you play for Jonah? You run through it in your mind as a classic rock guy, to Critical Mass to the Last Whale by Crosby, Stills, Nash. Beautiful song. Nah, we're not going to do that one. I'm not a big fan of The Mouse, but when The Mouse is right, The Mouse is right. The Little Mermaid. Announcement. I'm seeing it, and if it was in there last week, I missed it, that on September 8th, I believe, we are reverting back to the regular schedule. So that means we'll be meeting at 9 o'clock and 10:45 here at the Worship Center and back to our normal run and our normal routines after our summer's enjoyments. So mark that down and plan on being here because we don't want to be here by ourselves at 9 o'clock on that Sunday morning. And there'll be more regarding that. And Deb has an announcement regarding nursery. Let's stand together as we sing.
Stories of to the cross I look, to the cross I cling, of its suffering I do dream, of its work I do sing. On it my Savior, though bruised and crushed, showed that God is love, and God is just. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. What a priceless gift, undeserved life have I been given through Christ crucified. He called me out of death, he called me into life. I was under your wrath, now through the cross I'm reconciled. At the cross you reckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. Cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. In all of the cross I must confess, how wondrous your redeeming love, and how great is your faithfulness. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
Please be seated, and let's pray together. Father, in the midst of all that's taking place in the world today, and especially in our country, what we need is a good, fresh dose of the view of the cross. We need to see love enthroned in the midst of that suffering and that pain. A love that reached down and is willing to touch each and every one of our lives. No matter how confused and baffled and how angry and frustrated and lost and undone we may be, the cross supplies for us an endless source of grace and mercy and peace. And we are boggled in our minds to understand how it could be so. Why you would do that for us, because a lot of us won't even go across the street for the sake of our neighbors and their need, but you sent your only son to come and show us your love, supremely who you are, and how much you care for us, providing him as a sacrifice that none of us could really begin to think out or even imagine paying. But because the scripture says so, from cover to cover, we believe that it was your plan, it was your purpose, and it was your desire for us all along. That in spite of our sin, in spite of our rebellion, the things that we just can't seem to want to get around in terms of our minds and our heads, things that we can't begin to understand, we can understand this, that Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so, and so does the Holy Spirit. Working in and through us and your anointed servants over the years to declare the message of peace, the message of hope, the message of salvation. That hopefully up to this point we've heard and we've responded to in a glorious amen and yes, that's for me. And if not, then perhaps today's the day, Lord. Perhaps there are some still baffled in their confusion here today or just uncertain. And they're wondering what this Jesus stuff is all about. We pray, Lord, that today will be a day when another brick is removed from the wall to steal something from Pink Floyd. And that wall will come tumbling down and resistance will end and people will find exactly what this song is talking about, a sweet, sweet surrender of ourselves to you and your purposes. And there are those who need that here today. They're upset about everything that's going on in their lives, of the unrest and the uncertainty in the political climate and why people can't just seem to get along. They're undone because of things that others have done to them and about them, things they've said and things they've intimated, and they're not sure quite how to respond. We follow Jesus' example. When stuff was hurled at him and insults and threats came, he was silent because he knew the truth would win out. Just following Jesus seems a pretty good plan. And so, Lord, we ask that in the course of this hour that we're here together, that you would walk among us freely, that you would encourage us if we need that, that you would touch our bodies, touch our minds, touch our lives, if it's encouragement or if it's strength or if it's hope or healing that we need, because we know you are the God who hears and answers prayer and heals. And there are people who need your touch right now, and I'm thinking right now of Robin as she's getting ready for surgery and the doctors have said something needs to happen before we can do that. And so, Lord, in your power, will you touch her? And you will you restore the blood levels to where they need to be so that this thing can happen if it's supposed to happen in terms of her knee replacement. We leave her in your care. We love her dearly. We know you do as well, Lord. So who is it that you want to be in our lives today, Lord? What is it that you want to speak to our hearts? Help us to unstop our ears, to open up our hearts a little bit and give full attention to what it is your Spirit wants to convince us of and how he wants to use your servant today to do that. As we give you praise, as we give you glory, as we give you honor in Christ Jesus, in his name we pray. Amen.
storms in me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer
We are very privileged this morning. When did you take Greek, Randy? Where are you at?
I'm right here.
When did you take Greek?
Well, I took it the first time back in Roberts in the 90s, and then I took it again when I was at seminary.
Okay, and who was your Greek teacher?
You might know him.
I think we might know him. Yeah, Pastor John was Randy's Greek teacher when he was in college. Did you go to Northeastern or did you go to Asbury?
Northeastern.
Northeastern. So was he teaching Greek at that point in time?
Well,
or did they give it to Wayne McCown?
I finished up my schooling, and then they said, we made a mistake. You need 3 more credits. You can take anything at all. I was pastoring in Niagara Falls and had a new little girl at the time, didn't want to travel all the way back and forth again. So John was generous and came out, and we did master's level Greek during her nap time.
Sweet. That's what you call getting it done. Randy has pastored churches in Niagara Falls, Colonial Heights, and in Albion. He's also helped out down in Warsaw early on in his ministry, and he's taken on a wonderful new opportunity. The Lord has opened a door and called him to be a conference evangelist, actually a church-wide evangelist. That means he'll be traveling all over and declaring the truth that is in Christ Jesus and telling people how to make peace with God and come to Christ. And I'm excited for him, and I'm excited for what he's going to share with us this morning.
Thank you. Well, it is a privilege to be here this morning. I know some of you I'm meeting for the first time. There's others who I've certainly seen and met before. So glad to be here. I was talking to Leslie. Leslie and I, we were on a missions trip together back in 2001 to the Dominican Republic. And just some fantastic memories from that as well. Well, today we are going to talk about Jonah. We're going to talk more than just about Jonah. But I do want to start out there, and I'll just let you know ahead of time that we're not going to read every word. There are the references listed there in your bulletin, because I always think it's good to have you go and look back over. I'm going to paraphrase some, though, and hopefully John will approve how I paraphrase the Greek. I want to talk about a man that was called by God, but he did everything wrong. You know, we often like to look at those that they did everything right, but there's things that we can learn from those that did everything wrong as well. I love the VeggieTales clip in the beginning. I didn't know that's what was going to be there. I went and saw that at the movie theater 3 times when it was out. Many more since. In fact, when I was younger, even in college, we had all the VeggieTales. I had to get married and have kids to justify it. But it was one of the lyrics later on in that movie is so correct. It says, Jonah was a prophet, but you know he never got it. And so we're going to look at why he never got it, and hopefully we'll get it here today. Well, if you are following along there in your bulletin, I do have three fill-ins there. And the first thing I want to talk about is how Jonah went the wrong way. Jonah went the wrong way. When I first moved to Niagara Falls, it was back in 1998, I was directionally challenged. This was back, didn't have GPS, didn't have cell phone or anything back then. And so, you know, people would try to give me pretty clear directions, especially when I was starting out visitation. And so this one older couple from the church, Dick and Verna, they invited me to come out and visit with them. And they said, it's really easy, you know, it's all right turns. And so they told me where they were, and okay. So I start traveling out that day from the church, and I can't find the first road. And I'm going further. And I'm going further. Well, eventually I'm in Lockport. And they live in Niagara Falls. And, of course, again, don't have a phone, can't check in. So I go all the way back to the church and I call them. Well, what they assumed I would know was it's all right turns after you turn left out of the church. You can do everything right. You do one thing wrong, you're going to end up where you don't want to be. And that's what we find out about Jonah. Obviously, you know, Jonah is someone who had done right before. Otherwise, he wouldn't have been called to speak on behalf of God as a prophet. But it says here in Jonah 1:1-3, that the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port, and after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Now, sometimes we talk about, you know, fleeing from our calling. You know, pretty much most pastors I've talked to, at least in some way, they've struggled with their call. You know, struggle with the worthiness of the call. I know that I certainly did. Lord, isn't there someone else? But that wasn't Jonah's struggle, right? I can't vouch for the fish slapping, but everything else that it taught there in that VeggieTales clip was true. You know, Nineveh was the capital of Assyria, you know, enemies of Israel. They treated Israel horribly. And Jonah, you know, he looked at them through that lens. That's all he could see. And so it wasn't that he was fleeing from the Lord in the sense that he was afraid what God was going to do to him. He was fleeing because he was afraid of what God might do for the Ninevites. And before we throw Jonah under the bus, we may all have experienced something like that. You know, the last couple of years, I've been out to Israel, and then last year went out to Bulgaria working with the Roma, the gypsies, who, if you didn't know, they were actually the first to go into the gas chambers during the Holocaust. You know, both a set of people that were just treated so horribly and continue in many ways even today. Imagine being back, you know, in Germany or Warsaw, back in the 40s, and God puts it on your heart to go and to speak into the life of Hitler or the Nazis so that not only will they understand what they're doing is wrong, but so they can repent. So they might find God's grace. That would be difficult, right? Because there's a lot of people that probably would think, no, they deserve what's coming to them. Why should they get a chance to get out from this? They should have to suffer the consequences. Now, thankfully, there are many that actually did that very thing and went and, you know, were graceful and even went back to their captors and shared God's love. And we praise God for that. But you can understand from a flesh, from a human side of things, where that would be difficult. Another thing is that, you know, it's easy for us to say, well, I would never go the opposite direction like Jonah. If God asked me to do something, you know, I'm not going to run away. But we might stay where we are. We might hesitate. Now, I brought my friend Dave with me. My family's back there. We're still searching for a church to call home for when I'm not preaching everywhere else, but for them. So Dave came out with me. Let's say that God has called Dave, and what's your name? Dan? Okay, Dan is God. But God's called Dave to go over and over in the area here, Debbie, Nikki, and just to share his word over there. Well, Dave decides, well, I'm not going to run away like Jonah, but he just stays where he is. Well, where do you think God's going to go? God goes before us. God's going to go over there. And so even though Dave didn't run in the opposite direction, look at the gap that is caused because of that. That's what happens when God calls us to do something and we just sit still. And so it's easy to, again, look down on Jonah, but how many times have we done that in our own lives? You know, we've sat still when God said go. We also need to make sure that we are keeping our focus on Christ, that we're very attentive to where he's going, to what he's doing, so that we can be a part of that. The problem is sometimes we get so focused on other things, so distracted that we miss out. My honeymoon, my wife and I, we went down to, down to Cancun. And my wife, she's loves the ocean, loves the water. I wasn't always that big on it. I don't care for the things that swim in the ocean, things like that, not just whales. Well, we went down, and we got to choose a couple of excursions, and so I chose to go to Chichen Itza, the Inca pyramids, you know, right on dry land. It was great. She chose to go to Expuha, this, you know, beautiful beach area. Unfortunately, the day we went there, she was very sick, and she ended up just laying down on the beach and sleeping through most of it. Well, I got bored, and so finally, I got a little a floaty thing I rented there, and I just went out just in the, you know, the shallow water where it was blue, and I could see everything, and I felt pretty safe. And I looked out, and there was nothing but ocean. I mean, just absolutely nothing. And it was very relaxing. And the water would just kind of come in and, you know, the just float over. And it was great. And I was just kind of laying there on my side and for a long time. And, you know, just about ready to fall asleep almost. When all of a sudden I heard these voices from the distance. And they were yelling. And all I could hear, or at least all I could understand, was sharks. So I turned my head back around, and I was nowhere near the beach. I was way out. Did not intend to. I don't know how I got back. I may have walked on water. I don't know. I got back as fast as I could. But you know what? If I had been laying the other direction, if I had been focused on the beach, something that was, you know, set in place, that never would have happened. But there was no perspective when I was looking out to the ocean. You know, that's why we keep our focus on Christ. You know, he is unchanging, the same yesterday, today, and forever. So we need to make sure that whether it's intentional or unintentional, that we're not creating a gap between us and God because he has said go and we're still where we are. Now, moving on here in the chapter, verse 4, it says that the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down, and he fell into a sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he'll take notice of us so that we will not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they questioned Jonah. They try and find out, you know, what's going on. They knew that he was a servant of the Lord. They wonder what he had done. And he fully admits what's going on and how he's, you know, kind of jumped on board with them to go in the opposite direction. And they're trying to figure a way to fix this. And he says, "Well, throw me off." Well, they don't want to do that because they don't want the repercussions. They don't want to have something happen to them because they figure if this is God's man, God's going to do something to anyone that does something to him. And so it's also ironic that even though the reason why Jonah was with them was because he didn't care about the Ninevites and what happened to them, but here he cared about these strangers on a ship so much that he was willing to sacrifice his own life for them. Well, eventually the storm continued on. It got worse. And so they said, "Lord, please forgive us. You're the one that brought the storm." And they heaved him over. And of course, the storm, it calms right down. And it says, "Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights." Now, what would you do if you're in the belly of a fish? Not a lot of options. And what his option was crying out to the Lord, right? A lot of people, they like to think, well, that maybe this is just an analogy, maybe, or we talk about, you know, a whale oftentimes, thinking, well, something had to be big enough to be able to do this and so forth. But, you know, I take it as it is. I figure the same God that could feed 5,000 families with a couple fish and five loaves of bread can, you know, sustain a man a few days in a fish as well. But while he's in there, he's got a lot to think about. And I'm sure one of the things is simply, get me out of here. Now, it is very difficult to talk to God and ask him for help when you have kind of cut off communications with him, when you're unwilling to help others. You know, he's trying to talk with you, you block him out, but then when you want something, you want to open up the door. I find that there's many Christians that really struggle in their walk, and it's because they don't understand that there is a direct connection between the vertical and the horizontal relationships that we keep. You know, that vertical relationship with God, it works within our horizontal relationship with one another. That's why, you know, when we're praying like the Lord's Prayer, and we pray, you know, Father, forgive me just as I have forgiven them. Or Jesus said, you know, if you forgive them their sins, then your sins will be forgiven. Too often we want to withhold forgiveness for someone else while asking forgiveness for ourselves, and it's not going to happen. That's that wall that we build, it's all or nothing. It goes right around. Well, thankfully, God is gracious, and even though Jonah was doing all this to flee what he had been called to do and to help others, he was willing to help Jonah. And so that's where we come to chapter 2. And, you know, I did take Greek from John. Unfortunately, I never got to study under his twin brother who taught Hebrew. But I'm willing to bet that if we look at the original translation here for John chapter 2, it probably goes more like this. Help! There's no way he's in there writing this eloquent prayer. You know, maybe that was happening in the spirit. But, you know, it really was. It was, God, obviously I'm in the wrong here. Help me. Get me out of here. You know, it was a prayer of repentance. You know, repentance is simply doing a 180 from the direction where you are, going away from the Lord and then now going back toward the Lord. And while he was praying that, the fish was doing a physical 180. And so it brought him back to the place where he was originally meant to be. And so here he is. He's being spit out upon the shore there. He's back at Nineveh where he's supposed to be. But even though now that he has gone in the right direction, the second thing that Jonah does wrong, he adopted the wrong attitude. He adopted the wrong attitude. You know, God told him to go, you know, to share what was coming, what was going to happen if they didn't repent and so forth. And Jonah, he did do that. He did keep his word. You know, he walked all throughout and he did go ahead and share this out. But it wasn't because he cared for the people. It wasn't because he wanted them to listen. It was simply because of what he had promised God, because God had helped him out. He still had hope that many would end up suffering, that they wouldn't listen, that it would fall upon callous hearts. But it says here, when he was crying out, let everyone call, I'm sorry, the king said that everyone should call out urgently to God. And he says, who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on the destruction that he had threatened. But Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That's why I tried to forestall my fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it's better for me to die than to live. But the Lord replied, is it right for you to be angry? You know, just when you think that Jonah's finally getting it, you know, he's gone and done this thing that God's called him to do, and the result is one of the biggest mass revivals, right? I mean, just amazing. I would love to be a part of something like that, but at the end of it, rather than rejoicing, he gets angry at God because he's so loving and so compassionate. You know, how many times do you hear people being upset at God for those things? And yet that's where he was. His heart had just really grown so callous toward the Ninevites. All he could think about was himself, his own emotions, his own reactions. And so he goes and he sits upon this hill, and he kind of watches. He's still hoping that something's going to happen. They're going to mess up. God's going to take them out. But he waits and waits. And while he waits, says that, it's getting very hot there. And the sun is beating down on his head. And God allows this vine to grow up over him. And he's very happy about the vine. But then God provides a worm, eats the vine, it dies. He gets very upset. And again, he wants to die. Jonah is very dramatic. And you know, here, Jonah picked the wrong priorities. God said, don't you get it? I mean, literally, what God had just done for him, saving him from the belly of that fish because of his repentant prayer and bringing him to safety, it's the exact same thing that he was doing with the Ninevites. But Jonah just could not see the difference, or he couldn't see the similarity, rather. God said, don't you understand? These are my children. You know, they're a nation of thousands. They don't even know their left from their right. They don't know what they're doing. You know, one thing I've noticed about the church that I pray changes more and more as we go into the future is that we rarely want to look at ourselves and see how God, you know, wants to change us. But we all too easily look at those out in the world and we can judge what they're doing wrong, even though they don't know what's right or wrong. We do. And yet, oftentimes, we don't do it. And that's where Jonah was. He just didn't understand. And he's not alone. There are other times in Scripture that we see this. One of my favorite is when Jesus is telling a parable in Luke 15. At the time, some of the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, the religious, you know, hierarchy, they couldn't understand why Jesus spent so much time with sinners, with tax collectors, with prostitutes. You know, doesn't he know these guys that are over here and they're drinking and he's talking with them? He's getting a bad reputation. And so he tells this parable in their presence. He talks about how there's a man that has two sons. And the older son, you know, he's kind of the, that firstborn, the loyal, wants to help out, help run the family business, which happened to be a farm. But the younger son, he's a little more rebellious. And he thinks that he knows best and that there's got to be more to life than just this. And so he asks his father for an inheritance. Now, when would you typically get an inheritance? When somebody dies, right? So in other words, it's, you know, you're better off to me dead. I just want what you have, not who you are. And the father gives it to him. And it says that he goes away and he squanders it. He squanders it with wild living. It's like, you know, nowadays if you went out to Vegas and just wasted your money on all the things that offers. You know, we often call this the parable of the prodigal son. And we think prodigal means, you know, rebelling from God, but prodigal just means a spendthrift, you know, wasting away your money. And that's exactly what he did. And then a famine came, and he fell on hard times, and so he went to work for another farm. And this was not like his father's farm. And of all the jobs that he could get, he took care of the pigs. Imagine a nice young Jewish boy taking care of these unclean animals. And it got even worse because he was so hungry, it said that when he would feed the pigs, he wanted to eat the pods that he was feeding to them. I grew up raising pigs when I was younger. We always had a few. And I never once looked in there and thought, I'd like to join them. But he was desperate. So desperate that he finally started to think about who his father really was. and the kind of care and compassion that he had and how he treated his servants. And he thought, you know, I may have squandered my rights to be his son, but if I can convince him to let me be his servant, I'll be treated better than this. And so he heads back, and I can just picture him the whole way, just, you know, rehearsing this whole speech, you know, trying to gain sympathy, you know, saying, I know I can't be your son, but, you know, would you please consider this, and so forth. But as he's getting closer, all of a sudden, you see this kind of speck in the distance. And it's getting bigger, and it's coming faster. The father, rather than, you know, being upset and disappointed in the son, rather than saying, well, if that's all he wants is my stuff, then take it, and you know what? When it's gone, you're on your own. No. Every day he waited and watched. And one day in the distance, he saw his son. And he ran to him. There's an old song by Benny Hester, and it talks about, you know, all these great things of God, how mighty he is. He's the great I am, you know, mighty conqueror. He says, the only time I ever saw God run was when he ran to me, wrapped me in his arms, pulled my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. Lifted my chin, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his heart. He said, my sons, come home again. The only time I ever saw God run. And that's just what the father did. Before the son could even get that prepared speech out, you know, he's already got the royal robes and rings being put on him. He's already wrapped in the arms of his father. He's already being restored as a son. Not a servant. And it's just this amazing sense of love and grace that's taking place. And it turns into a celebration. And the fattened calf is going to be killed, and everyone's going to be invited, and everyone's excited about this except for who? The older brother. It's not fair. He's been there all along. He's been doing this all along. Why should his younger brother that went and squandered everything come back and then even get more inheritance as well? Why should he be able to join back in with the family as well? He did not get it. Jonah did not get it. The Pharisees and teachers of the law at that time did not get it. It doesn't matter what our children do. It may be things that we don't approve of. It may be things that hurt us. But ultimately, we love them. He says, my son was lost and now he's found. My son was dead and now he's alive. Can't you understand how significant this is? I want to share one last father-son story. There was a young boy, 8 years old, had older siblings, much older, 25, 26 years older. You know, he was a surprise. And the older siblings, they were kind of troublemakers, and they got themselves into situations. And so his father, when he was 8 years old, he was suffering from some depression as well. He'd had a heart attack and so forth. He said to his 8-year-old son, I'm done with this. I don't want to do this anymore. I've already done it. And so basically from that day on, cohabitated. You know, had a separate room even from his mother. You know, lived in the same house but did not participate at all. In his life, never went to any school events, never went to any sporting events. You know, the boy would be asked often if his parents were divorced or if his father was dead, and he would go along with it because it was easier than explaining the reality. Well, you can imagine someone growing up in that situation, and just the resentment building, the frustration, the anger. At 15, grandmother died. He moved in, took care of his grandfather, and then when his grandfather couldn't be left alone when school started, stayed there. Better than going back home, living on his own. And finally, graduation comes. It's time to go off to college. Chooses a college as far away as possible just to kind of get out of all the situation and to find God. He's going to go out to Kansas. Great place to find God. There's nothing else there. And as he is there, getting ready to get on the bus, gets on the wrong bus, thankfully notices, gets back off, starts to go on to the right bus, when his mother runs up and says, hey, your father actually came out today. You know, he really put forth an effort. You didn't even say goodbye to him. At which point, he didn't look back. He walked straight on the bus and thought, good. Maybe now he knows what it feels like. Well, when I got to Kansas, I did find God. I went out to Central College. And the night that I was praying and asking Jesus to come into my heart, the day that I was the prodigal whose father had come and wrapped his arms around him, it was during that same prayer when all of a sudden God said, what about your father? And let me tell you, all I could think was, what about him? He might as well have been from Nineveh. I wanted nothing to do with him. He didn't deserve it. It's amazing how quickly we can go from being the prodigal son to the older brother. And that's exactly the battle that was going on in my heart. And thankfully, God won out. And so during that prayer time, I pray, God, please give me a relationship with my father and give him a relationship with you. Well, I ended up coming back toward home anyway. I'm from Chautauqua County, down the country outside Jamestown. But I came back to Roberts Wesleyan College after being out there just for the 1 year. And I did develop a relationship with him. It was more of kind of a friendship. We played cards and talked and that. I was always probably more of the father figure out of it. He was older at the time too. And I would do my best to be able to share Christ with him. And I would leave him Bibles, and I'd come back, and I'd find they'd been used as doorstops. And every time I did try to talk about Jesus, he would quickly turn the subject into something else. And it became very frustrating. I really wanted him to know. And during this time, his health just continued to deteriorate. He had gone in twice. They said he had a month to live. Once they called us in and said, he will never make it through the night. And yet, believe it or not, doctors are wrong. And so he continued on. Well, this was 1992 when I prayed that prayer. Now jump up to 2005. I had just finished up my first year as head pastor in Albion. And I'd gone down to visit my dad, and I never knew what to find when he was there. He never answered the phone, and he lived way out in the sticks. And I got there, and there was no car, and he rarely left the house, so I was surprised. So I went back, and I find him back in his bed. Come to find out, he had been just in a very minor accident, but they'd found out he hadn't paid for insurance or registration for years. And I found a whole box of unopened bills and all these different things, and the fines were just enormous. And so they had taken his car, and he had to go to court. Well, for the next 6 months, I I basically worked with the Corps and everything else trying to figure out what we could do. And the judge finally said if he turned in his license and if he would allow me to move him out closer to where I was so that I could care for him, that he would drop all the charges and fines. And my father, to my surprise, said okay. Now, his home was his idol. He loved it. Loved it. It had been his mother's house before that. Lucille Ball used to have barn dances there, you know, early on. But moved him out to Albion, just 2 miles down the road from us, a nice little housing development so he could still have some of his own privacy and create community there. And I had a deal with him. He had smoked since he was 9. I did not like it. I'm allergic to smoke. But I said, listen, if you come out, I will buy your cigarettes every week for the first year. We can talk about the patch after that. I said, but you have to come to church each week too. And so we both kept our ends of the bargain, and I brought him out to church for a year. And at the end of that year, we were having a special service outside where Albion Free Methodist is located. There's a jail right across the street. And just because of the location, the way that the prisoners would be able to get, you know, kind of free time or get out in the air, they went up on the roof. And so we would get permission different times. We would set up and we'd do our service pointed, and they would go up on the roof and be a part of our worship. Well, I knew my father was, he loved guitars. At the time, it was more of a traditional service on Sunday morning, but we were doing guitars and everything that night. I love the harmonica here this morning, by the way. He played harmonica with Johnny Cash. And so it was a neat thing. Well, anyway, I brought him out, and at the end of that time, I just gave a very straightforward gospel message. I shared the good news. And on the way bringing him back to his apartment, he said to me, I heard every word that you said. Now, there's a significance there because even though my father didn't really interact with me as far as going to anything, he did interact with me in the sense that he, you know, there was a lot of verbal abuse growing up. And I had to go to speech therapy all through school. God has a great sense of humor when he called me to preach. But one of the things he would always say to me was, I just can't understand you. Stop mumbling. And so something clicked when he said, I understood every word you said. And so I went back, and we ended up for the next 4 hours up in his apartment talking about things that had happened since the last time he had been at church, which was when he was 8 years old. You know, he had been in the hospital a lot when he was a child. He had been abused. He was in the army. He was there at the very end of World War II. And just some of the things that he experienced. All these things, they had built a wall up between him and God. And so we talked about freedom from that. We talked about breaking those chains, about, you know, what life could be like. And a little after midnight, I got to pray with my father, who was in his mid-70s at that point. And he received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And the first thing he did was he looked up, and for the first time, since I was a very small child, told me he loved me. That was 2006. 14 years after I prayed, Father, I prayed to have a relationship with him and him to have a relationship with you. Both were answered that night. And it was amazing just even what changes came over him during that time. And he has since passed. And even at the time, family members, others, they would wonder, why are you doing this? I took care of my father for a number of years, and it was a lot going on. And they'd say, why would you do that? Why would you take care of him the way that he didn't take care of you? Well, my response would be, because I'm a Christian, because we're not supposed to treat others the way they treat us. We're supposed to treat them the way we want to be treated or the way that Christ treats us. And some just didn't get it. And they say, well, don't you wish you had those years back when you were a kid? Well, of course I do. But you know what? I am so excited now because I know that I'm going to have eternity to make up for it with him. Because I know where he is. And I'm thankful that the God of second chances that gave me a second chance is the same God that gave my dad a second chance, who gave us a second chance. And so this morning, God may be speaking to you. You know, maybe you've been a little bit like Jonah, a little bit like the older brother. You know, maybe there's someone that God has put on your heart, but you feel like maybe they don't deserve it, or they've really hurt you. And so you think, well, maybe someone else will go. But I want to tell you this morning, if God says go, go. You know, on the action steps here in your bulletin, that first one, you know, if God has called me to go and do, then I'll go wherever he says and do whatever he asks. Some of the hardest places to go, it's not the other side of the world, it's the other side of the house. It's with your own family. And yet, God often calls us to do that. You know, maybe it's also a different thing. Maybe it's moving, maybe it's a ministry, maybe it's, you know, stepping up to the next level of your Christian walk, going from being a casual Christian to a committed Christian, whatever it is. You know, there are a lot of people that were very, very surprised, including me and my wife, when I, you know, walked away from being in a church for over 15 years, which probably doesn't seem like much here because John's been here forever, right? I was the longest tenured pastor and the oldest for Methodist Church. But to step away from that and from a salary and everything else, in order to do what God had called me to do, they said, well, what happened? I said, well, what happened was I practiced what I preached. God says, go, you go. And you put your faith in him. You know, the second thing there, you know, if I've wronged God or someone else, I will repent and seek reconciliation and restoration. It's not always easy to admit when you're wrong, but it's always better to go and to offer to restore that relationship. Now, certainly there are some situations where bringing things up, it's going to hurt the person more and maybe help you feel free. You want to weigh that out because the goal is to restore the relationship with the other so that your relationship with the Father can be fully restored as well. On the flip side, maybe someone else has sinned against you. Are you willing to show them compassion and give them a second chance? And a third chance? And a fourth chance? You know, if you want to know how many chances, you know, Peter once said, well, how many, seven? Jesus says, no, 70 times seven. And he wasn't telling him to do the math and then stop there. However many times it takes, how many times has God forgiven you? Go and do likewise. And then finally, if God puts someone on my heart that does not know Christ, I will persevere by praying persistently and not giving up hope. I hate to admit this, but even as a pastor, after years and after all the close calls with my father's health, I began to really doubt that he would ever come to the Lord. I'm thankful that I was wrong. And I always tell people, I said, you know what? If he can come to Christ, anyone can. Maybe there's someone that you've been praying about for years. Maybe it's someone that God just wants you to continue to show love to. Not that you have to beat them over the head with the Bible. But show them his love consistently, and he will give you opportunities. You know what? If God has put someone like that in your heart, write it down. You know, things become more permanent in our minds when we write them down. But write it, and don't stop praying. Don't stop loving on them. You know, my grandmother, she was the only Christian in my family growing up, and I overheard her many times. She prayed daily that I would be a pastor. And it wasn't until she died that was the catalyst for me to become a Christian. Don't give up, but keep praying. And so if any of these things today, if they resonate with you, I'm just going to ask you just to stand. I want to pray with you before turning things back over to Herb. But let's just go to God in prayer today and ask him to use us and give us the courage to be used by him. Father God, thank you so much for your love and your great compassion. Thank you, Lord, that you treat us very differently, Lord, than how maybe we treat others or we would want to treat others. Thank you, Father, that you are gracious and that you have more than love for us, Lord. You offer us more than mercy. You offer us grace, Lord, what we don't deserve. You offer us that second, third, fourth, fifth chance. Lord God, you offer us your Son, Jesus Christ, who, Lord, in your word in Romans 5, it says he didn't wait for us to come to him, even like the prodigal son. He ran first. It says that he came and he died for us when we were still sinners. When there was no reason to believe that even one would turn to him, he was still willing to sacrifice so much. And so, Lord, I pray that we would live a life where we would sacrifice ourselves. We would sacrifice our rights, what we think is fair, how others perceive us, Lord, in order to be able to speak into others' lives and share and show your love. And so, Father, I pray for anyone here today, anyone, Lord, that needs to know that love themselves. Father God, I pray that you would be with them. I pray, Lord, for anyone here today that needs to show that love in a very specific way. And Father God, I pray today for anyone who has felt like giving up on someone. Lord, I pray that you would just continue. And just as the Father waited and watched and didn't give up, Lord, I pray that you would continue to give them perseverance through their prayers. And Father, that you would do all that you can, because we know that you love that person even more than they do. It's your child. And you want nothing more than them to be restored and called your son or daughter again. Be with us now, Christ, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Randy, so very much. Keith and, go ahead and be seated. Keith and Jim, Keith and Jim are going to be circulating amongst us while we're playing the first verse of this song, and they're going to be gathering up our connection cards that you filled out earlier and also receiving anything that you have in the way of an offering. You don't need to put an offering. You don't need to put anything in that basket this morning, but if the Lord has urged you on it, we encourage you to do it, and let's continue to serve the Lord together.
Every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and of earth, known to comprehend your worth, king over all the universe, to you be the glory. I'm alive because I'm alive in you. All because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me and raises dead men's lives. It's all because of Jesus.
land. Giver of every breath that breathes, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, you be the glory. Maker of heaven, a standing earth, no one can comprehend your birth. King of all the universe, you be the glory. I'm alive because I'm alive in you. It's all because of Jesus, I'm alive. It's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. He covers me and raises dead men's lives. It's all because of Jesus. Every sunrise sings your grace. The universe cries out your praise. Singing freedom all my days, now that I'm alive. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Who covers me and raises dead men's lives. It's all because of Jesus. Every sunrise sings your grace. The universe cries out your praise. Singing freedom all my days. Now that I'm alive. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ covers me and raises dead men's lives. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive.
John's going to be back next week. Psalm 31. Ask you to pray for me and Leah this week because we're going to be driving up from Florida Tuesday. Take a couple days. I'll be back next Sunday, but just keep us in mind as we're on the road bringing all her stuff up here as she goes back. And remember that Jesus loves you. And Jesus likes you. And Jesus wants to hang out with you. And I think it'd be a pretty good idea if you stepped up and did that this week. You both enjoy it. Thanks for being here.
It's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ covers me and raises dead men.